Hi, I'm Ian, and today we're going to be modifying the Chicago Electric Dual MIG 131 welder. Out of the box, 20-something years ago, it left a bit to be desired. And today, we're going to try and correct some of those shortcomings to get it a little more useful. But first, what am I going to use it for? Well, I want this thing set up with small wire. Depending on what brand wire you get, it's either going to be called 0.023, 0.024, or 0.025 wire. The metric equivalent is 0.6 millimeters. The thin stuff for auto body work, doing patch panels, exhaust systems, stuff like that in the 20 gauge to 18 gauge range. I'm sick of changing over the wire and the drive rolls and the contact tip in my other welder for this stuff, so I figure I've got this little thing, it's been kicking around my barn under the welding table for years. Time to give it a new use as the dedicated sheet metal welder. This thing had one big benefit to being a sheet metal welder versus the current Vulcan line of Harbor Freight welders. That is, the Vulcan line tries to be handy with a 5-second post-flow timer. So, for the shielding gas, you're welding along, shielding gas is flowing out the nozzle. At the end of the weld, you let go of the trigger, and the weld stops. On the Vulcan line, and a lot of the newer inverter MIG welders, it keeps the gas solenoid open for 5 seconds in order to keep shielding gas flowing over the cooling puddle, so that way the oxygen and nitrogen in the air don't attack it as it cools down. That's super handy if you're welding stainless steel or reactive metal like that. Mild steel, not that big a deal. And it's downright not handy if you're trying to do sheet metal work where you're trying to keep the distortion down by doing spot weld here, spot weld there, spot weld here, spot weld there, moving all around, because you might only have the trigger pulled for half a second or a full second, but then as soon as you let go, the shielding gas keeps flowing for another 5 seconds. Well, you're now using 5 times the shielding gas that you really need, and you have no way of turning that feature off. It would be okay if in the menu system of the OmniPro 220 you could turn off the post flow. That'd be really nice. But you can't, so therefore I don't like using that one for sheet metal work. I have the MIG 170 that we put the Euro style connector on the front so it can use different guns and stuff like that. That works well. Doesn't have a post-flow timer in it, so as soon as I let off the trigger, the shielding gas stops. But the downside to that is it's not super good on the low end, so it has a hard time with sheet metal. The other thing is that that has a 10-foot gun lead on it, which the 0.023 wire, being so thin, doesn't like pushing that far. This has a very short gun lead, that's only about 5 feet, which is a good length for the thin wire, plus the fact that it's small, so even though it's got a small lead to it, I can move the thing closer to the part I'm working on. This has the standard cheap setup of a valve in the MIG gun body to turn the shielding gas on and off. So you physically open the valve when you squeeze the trigger, and when you let off the trigger, the valve closes. It makes for a stiffer trigger than one that's just an electrical switch, but the beauty of this, in this case, is there's no post flow to it. As soon as I let off that trigger, shielding gas stops. So for doing a whole bunch of little spot welds, the gas is only flowing when I'm actually welding, which is perfect. So, I have high hopes for this little thing. I've used it a couple times and it does work remarkably well for what it is. It just has some drawbacks to it, and that's what we're going to address today. This thing is built to use 2-pound spools of wire. If I open up the side, you will see the issue. It has this little spindle for small spools. That's okay, but it is really, really hard to find 0.023 diameter solid wire in a 2-pound spool. And when you do find it, it's expensive. The most cost-effective way to get it is a 10 or 11-pound spool. 10 and 11-pound spools are both 8-inch diameters, so physically they're the same size. One just has one extra pound of wire in it. The problem, then, becomes how do you take a big opening like this and get it to work with that spindle? You could 3D print an adapter for it, or I've seen instructables where you take an old spool of the 2-pound wire, cut it apart, screw it into this thing, and then mount it on there. But that's a lot of effort. And for $11, I was able to get a replacement spool holder for the Chicago Electric MIG-170 that is designed to handle both 2-pound spools and 10-pound spools. So the easiest thing to do is just take out this old spindle, replace it with a new spindle. The first thing I want to do is remove the sheet metal. I can't put the new spindle in here exactly centered on where the old one was because the spool would hit the back and it would be up too high, because you really want this little feed tube to be as close to tangent with the edge of the wire as possible. That way it has the easiest time feeding the wire out. So I think right here ought to be good. I might be able to cheat it up just a little bit more like that, and that should be just about perfect. The other thing that is going to cause a little bit of problems, but I think we can work around it, is the fact that this bolt sticks up. If I take a piece of wood and I rest it on the edges where the sheet metal door hits, this thing sticks up about a quarter of an inch, which means the door's not going to close all the way. I can't trim this thing down because it needs all these threads in order to properly tension this big spool. When I put the nut on, it comes right down flush with the top to provide the correct amount of tension. Like that. So the threads have to stay. I think what I'm going to do is, once this is bolted in place, I'm going to mark the door and I'm going to take a hole saw and cut a hole right there, because the door already has louvers in it, so it's not like this is an airtight compartment, and the easiest thing is going to be just cut a hole in the door for this thing to stick out a little bit. In case you're thinking about doing this modification, it's 4 1/8 inches from the edge of the bolt to here, and 4 1/2 from the edge of the bolt to down here. This is the high-tech hole drilling apparatus, and if you're wondering why I have a random scrap of wood on the drill bit, this is the high-tech depth stomp. The problem is, under here, on the other side, you have the reactor choke and the transformer with their windings in line with where these holes are going to be. And I'm afraid that if I try to drill it without some sort of positive stop on this thing, when the drill bit breaks through the sheet metal, it's going to grab, force the drill down, and drill into those windings. And I don't want to have to rewind those things. So this is to avoid that. So it can only go in about 1/8 inch, which is plenty to drill the hole in the sheet metal. No destruction to the windings. One thing you want to check out when
inspecting any MIG welder, especially a MIG welder that's going to be using this really thin welding wire, is right here. The contact point of the drive roll is right here, and the liner that goes up the cable to the gun is actually nowhere to be seen. So you have this really big gap that's at least half an inch here, and I don't know how far up in here this thing goes. That is asking for trouble, because if there's any kind of restriction in the gun liner or the contact tip gets blocked somehow with this fine wire, when these drive rolls decide it's going to push it that way, these rollers don't care if it's actually going up the gun liner or not. It could just form what's known as a bird's nest right here. And it's called a bird's nest because that's what it looks like. And it's a pain in the butt because you got to cut it, pull it out of the liner, redo everything. And it's just not a lot of fun. The easiest way to avoid that, or at least significantly reduce the risk of that happening, is you need the end of the liner to be as close to the contact point of these rollers as possible. Here, it's as far away as possible. I've taken the four screws that hold this part off, and if we look, here's the end of the liner right here. So that's a good 3/4 of an inch. That is really pushing it for regular 0.030 wire or larger. It is really, really pushing it for the small wire that we're going to be running on this thing. The good news is there's an easy fix. All I got to do is just pull the liner back a little bit. And I want to get this thing just as close as possible. Now I want to be careful that it's not actually contacting the drive roll and the little pressure roller, because if I jam it in there too far, it could actually keep these things apart, because of course this is spring loaded to squeeze the wire into the groove, and I don't want this liner to wedge them apart. So I'll get it so it's almost touching but not quite, and use this little center punch just to hold it in place, because it is kind of springy. And I can go ahead and tighten down this clamp again. And that is going to go a long ways towards preventing any bird's nesting. Like I said, this thing was set up to be able to use shielding gas, and we are definitely going to be using shielding gas for welding sheet metal. And this is the gas connection that came on it from the factory. It's a little nylon tube. This is actually the same tube that runs all the way up the gun lead to the valve in the gun. And they were kind enough to put about 2 feet out the back to connect to a regulator. This is very stiff, and I see the potential for it to kink, and you need a special fitting. This is 4 millimeter nylon tube, and I know that for two reasons. One, I put my calipers on it, and it told me. And two, after I was done putting the calipers on it, I happened to notice that it tells me 4 millimeters right on the side of it. So I went online and I ordered a 4 millimeter push connector to 1/4 inch pipe thread. Then I had a 1/4 inch pipe thread to 1/4 inch pipe thread coupler laying around, and I ordered 1/4 inch pipe thread to inert gas fitting. This takes the tapered fitting that standard shielding gas hoses have on them, so that way I can use the same hose that's on my other MIG welders on this thing. This, however, came just as the brass fitting, not this black mounting plate with the holes. I made the mounting plate out of some 1/8-inch steel I had kicking around, drilled the holes, and then I used some silver solder to solder the brass fitting to the plate. So that way we have bolt holes for the plate, we can mount the plate, and then that will give us a nice rigid connection, because I was afraid if this was just left loose on the end of this thing, eventually it would pull itself off this little hose. So we're going to tuck this thing back inside. So the first thing I want to do is to feed this hose back through the hole. So we have this hole. It's not big enough for the threads to go through. So I'm going to use a step bit and enlarge that. Let's see, is that big enough? It is. And it fits perfectly, so now I can go ahead and drill the mounting holes. I've gone ahead and wrapped Teflon tape on these threads because it's going to be a whole lot easier with it out to do that than when it's in the hole. I'm putting a little bit of Loctite on these threads so that way it won't work itself loose as I connect and disconnect the shielding gas hose over time. There, that connects the push connect fitting to the shielding gas fitting. And if you're wondering why I couldn't just drill the hole in the back of the welder and sandwich it together using this, the problem is it's national pipe thread here. And that's a tapered connection that seals up as it tightens up. The problem with that is I couldn't run it all the way in to squeeze the sheet metal, because where it tightens up, you can't see it on camera, but there's still a good 1/8-inch gap between the end of this coupler and the back of this sheet metal. And that's with the 1/8-inch plate right here. So there was no way that was going to fit. The other issue with that is even if I could tighten it up, that wouldn't prevent this thing from spinning as I tighten the gas hose on. So this is really the best way of doing it. Now all I need to do is trim this down and I can reconnect that here. One thing that interests me about the inside of this welder is the severe lack of dust in the thing. Yeah, it has some dust in the bottom of it, but that's really not much considering the fact that it's a welder that is 23 years old. Usually, they're just caked full of grinding dust and all sorts of random shop dust. And this one really isn't. And I think part of the reason for that is the severe lack of a cooling fan. If you notice, there's no cooling fan. It's got the cutout for a cooling fan. It even has mounting holes for a cooling fan, but there is no cooling fan. And again, this thing was built to a price. My guess is that price was $5, and in doing so, things had to be eliminated, and part of that was the cooling fan. I've thought about putting a 120-volt muffin fan in here, but I've decided against it for the simple reason that I've done welding with this thing, and I don't think it needs a fan. I'm using it for sheet metal, and I'm deliberately taking my time so that way panel doesn't warp on the vehicle, and by doing so, this thing has adequate time to cool down, because it's a couple tack welds, I let the panel cool down, this thing's also cooling down. It just, for what I use it for, I don't run long continuous beads that would cause this thing to heat soak in here, so I'm not adding a fan to it, because it's actually kind of nice to have a welder that can be on and you're not listening to a fan drone away the whole time. So no fan for it. But if you're wondering why there's no fan, that's why there's no fan. Other than that, it looks pretty good to go in here. The transformer, the reactor choke are tipped back. The sheet metal feet on the transformer are bent, so my guess would be that this thing got dropped on its back at some point, and the weight of these things caused the sheet metal feet to bend. I'm not going to do anything about it because it's really not hurting anything. I can't see that it's bent when the cover's put back on, so it's not going to bug me as much. And I don't really want to risk cracking the weld that holds this foot onto this transformer. And I don't want to have to take all the wires off, pull these things out, and try and straighten it. So it's just going to stay like that. And after the cover's on for a little while, I'll forget that it looks like this. I had this welder outside and I was cleaning it off. And while I was doing that, I made a modification to the back side of this thing. And that is right down here. Originally, this welder had straps right here, nylon straps, that could hold a tiny little shielding gas cylinder on the back of this thing. You may have seen big roll-around MIG welders that had the cart built into the back for the shielding gas cylinder, and this had a tiny version of it, and it had this tray right there that was part of it. Well, the problem is I don't have a tiny little shielding gas cylinder, and if I put this on my welding cart, having this back end stick out like this caused the front of the welder to hang off the front of the cart. So I decided, while I was at it, I'd bring out the metal cutting jigsaw and simply cut off this tray. So that's what I did. I've put a couple of the screws back in their holes just to make sure the sheet metal cover is aligned where it's going to be. And now I need to mark the location of this bolt because I need to center the hole on it. Well, I think the easiest way to do that is to take, in this case, it's a little bit of Rust-Oleum primer, and just dab a little bit of primer on there. Now, this could be any kind of paint that's not blue. And I simply close the thing and push it right there, kind of wiggle it around so it makes good contact. And I am left with the mark from the bolt. Now I know exactly where that thing is, and we can drill it out. I drilled a small pilot hole in the center of the paint with a sharp bit so it wouldn't wander around, because the pilot bit on my hole saw is a little on the dull side and it tends to wander a little bit. So this way, this is a small pilot hole that will keep the pilot bit on the hole saw centered where it needs to be. And speaking of wandering, I think what we need to do is take these hinges off so that way I can take the door off and wander down to the barn where I have the hole saws and we can drill this hole. These hinges are plastic and there's a metal bar right here, and it looks like I should be able to just pull on this and pop that metal bar out of the plastic hinge. But this is cheap 23-year-old plastic, and I don't like my odds of being able to do that without the hinges breaking. So I'm not going to tempt fate with trying to flex these hinges enough to pop the door off when two nuts and the door comes right off. That inch and a half diameter hole should be perfect for the tensioning knob. Now I'll take a half round file and clean up the burr around this and we can reinstall it. Remember how I said I was afraid of the 23-year-old cheap plastic? Well, when I was trying to put the door back on, one of the little threaded parts broke off. So those hinges are now dead. I thought about trying to put hinges on here of some kind, but with this lip the way it is, that'd make it hard. I'd have to have a spacer for it or bend the hinge somehow. And honestly, this welder isn't worth it. So, luckily, because it has that lip, I can simply flop the side down on that, and that holds it in place. It can't slide off one side or the other because it has this knob sticking through the hole. The bottom doesn't pull out because it still has this latch, and as long as the latch stays down, that's good to go. And there are some MIG welders out there that have a completely removable door anyways. So I'm gonna say for this thing, that's good enough. It's not gonna rattle anyways because there's no fan to move in there. So at this point, we're pretty much all done. All we need to do now is get the wire from here out the gun so we can put the new tip on, and also to make sure that this old drive assembly has enough power to move this spool. I think it does, but we'll find out. So if I turn it on, notice how it's totally silent. That's due to lack of fan. Let's see what it does. I've got the wire speed cranked all the way up. And there it is. Now what we can do is turn the wire feed speed to a normal speed setting. I just set it halfway, and let's see what that does. Yup, much more reasonable. Now what I want to do is check to see if I have the right drive roll tension on here. So I'm going to back the tension knob all the way off, because I want enough tension that when I squeeze this thing lightly, it still moves, but no more. So that way, if it stops up completely, that reduces the chance of it bird's nesting. Because even though I've got that liner in as close to that drive roll as possible, with too much tension on it, it could still bend the wire out and cause a big mess. So let's see what this does. So I can stop it like that. So I'll give it a couple turns. Okay, that was pretty good. That was fighting me. I'm going to say that's good right there. So, with that being the case, I'm going to back it up a little bit more. And usually when I get a welder to that point where it'll fight me, I like to give the knob half a turn more. That should be good to go. We'll replace the nozzle. And I can put the side on. So that's pretty much it for upgrading this welder. Now there are two things that I've decided not to upgrade right now, but I might in the future depending on how things turn out. And that all has to do with the ground here. It comes with the typical cheap MIG welder jumper cable style clamp in place of a proper ground clamp. I'm leaving this for the time being because, for one thing, for being 23 years old, this thing is in perfect shape. It's not burnt or anything on it. It doesn't have a bunch of stubs of wire burnt off it like a porcupine. And for sheet metal work on cars, a lot of times I use a magnetic ground, which has a big magnet with a spring-loaded copper center. If this was a car, you'd grind off the paint right here, stick the magnet on with the copper touching the bare metal, and you can clamp this on the bolt that sticks out the back of that assembly. Well, the shape of this thing actually works perfectly for holding that bolt on the Tractor Supply magnetic ground. So that's why I'm hanging on to this thing, because for this use, this type is actually more ideal than the better quality ground clamps. And the other thing is, this ground cable is pathetically skinny. Looking at it in here, it looks like it's probably 6-gauge wire, which is kind of laughable. But it works, and for the low amperages that this thing gets used at, it gets a little warm, but not bad. So I think for the time being, because this is in good shape, the insulation's decent, and it's actual copper wire, plus the fact that ground cable or welding cable is stupid expensive right now, I'm simply going to leave this alone. In the future, if I decide I need to upgrade it, it's pretty easy to do because this goes in through the strain relief right here. And if I take off the cover, it just has a ring terminal on the end. So I don't have to take apart the rest of the welder in order to switch this out if I feel the need in the future. But for right now, I think that's going to be fine.